morning.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm just talking to people in Malayalam.
Please carry on. Please carry on. I just wanted to make sure that everything is okay.
Yeah, everything is perfect. Everything is perfect. I was thinking that, you know, everything I have provided, and the most important thing, that small thing link, I forgot to give you yesterday. You have everything, but that small key which is needed to... Yeah. What we will do is that we start the session at 11 o'clock itself, and then now we have about 30 odd people has joined, and other people will join. Today itself, actually, we have more than 200 registration. Hoping that we will have a full house today. But we'll start the session now itself, and it's 11 now, Indian time 11. So we are starting. We have people from different parts of Kerala. But just to introduce, I'll just talk in Malayalam and English, just to ensure that we are all same. Okay. Namaskaram ellavarkkum. Appa innatha nammal samsarikkan ponnathu sharia veil allega halal veil engane invest cheyadanu ennu kurichu. Appa ennodu chodikkaradengil enikku valare ottiri adhigam interest ulla oru karyam aanu ee sharia veil engane invest cheyadanu. Karena njan ee parivadi thodangitte ekadesham oru 6-7 varshayi njan idine kurichu padikkan thodangittu. Appa ഒത്തിരി കാര്യങ്ങൾ എനിക്ക് ഇതിൽ നിന്ന് പഠിക്കാനായിട്ടുള്ള ചാൻസ് കിട്ടിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോ ഇപ്പൊ എല്ലാവർക്കും ഒരു ചോദ്യം ഉണ്ടാവും, ഒരു നോൺ മുസ്ലിമായ എനിക്ക്, ഞാനത് മുസ്ലിം എന്നൊന്നും പറയുന്നില്ല, മനുഷ്യന്മാരിൽ ഒരു പ്രത്യേക ആൾക്കാർക്ക് ഒരു തരം ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ്മെന്റ് വേണം, ആ നീഡ് മനസ്സിലാക്കി അവരെ സപ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്യുക എന്നുള്ളത് എൻ്റെ ഒരു പ്രൊഫഷന്റെ ധാർമ്മിക ഉത്തരവാദിത്തമാണ്. അതിന്റെ പേരിലാണ് ഞാനിത് വളരെയധികം പാഷനേറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് കൂടി എടുത്ത് പഠിച്ച് പറയുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ എനിക്ക് തന്നെ ഒത്തിരി ക്ലയൻസ് എൻ്റെ അടുത്ത് ഉണ്ട് ഇത്തരം കാര്യങ്ങൾ ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ ഒരാളോടും ഞാൻ പറയാറില്ല ഇതൊരു ഇസ്ലാമിക് വേ ഓഫ് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റിംഗ് ആണ്, പക്ഷെ നിങ്ങളുടെ ഒരു ബിലീഫ് അനുസരിച്ച് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് സർട്ടൻ കാര്യങ്ങൾ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല, ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല, അതനുസരിച്ചിട്ട് ഞാൻ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അഡ്വൈസ് ചെയ്ത് തരാം ഇതിന് പറ്റിയ ഇന്ത്യയിൽ അവൈലബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബെസ്റ്റ് പ്രൊഡക്റ്റ് എന്താണെന്നുള്ളത്. അത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഞാൻ പറയുന്ന രീതിയിൽ കൺവിൻസിങ് ആണെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അത് ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യാം. ഇത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്താ പറയാ, ഇതൊരു വിശ്വാസത്തിന്റെ പുറത്തുള്ള ഇൻവെസ്റ്റിംഗ് ആണ്. ഇതിലൊരു എന്താ പറയാ, ഇതാണ് ശരി ഇതാണ് തെറ്റ് എന്നൊന്നുമില്ല. ഞാൻ ഇത്തരം കാര്യങ്ങൾ അന്വേഷിച്ച് ഇറങ്ങണമെങ്കിൽ ഐ മിക്സ് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ഓൾസോ, കാരണം ദേർ ആർ പീപ്പിൾ ഹു ഹാവ് ജോയിൻഡ് നോൺ മലയാളീസ് ഓൾസോ. അപ്പൊ ഞാൻ ഒത്തിരി കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഞാൻ ഇതിൽ പഠിച്ചിട്ടുള്ള കാര്യം വെച്ചാൽ ഇതൊരു ബിലീഫാണ്, ആ ബിലീഫിനെ പ്രൊട്ടക്ട് ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് നമുക്ക് എങ്ങനെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യാന്നുള്ളതാണ്. അപ്പൊ ഇതിന് ഞാൻ ബോംബെയിലായിരുന്ന ടൈമിൽ ഞാൻ ഒത്തിരി കാര്യങ്ങൾ എങ്ങനെ ഇൻവെസ്റ്റിംഗ് ഒരു ചെറിയ പോയിന്റ് ഓഫ് വ്യൂവിൽ വേണം എന്നുള്ളതിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് ഞാൻ പഠിക്കട്ടെ. അപ്പൊ ഒത്തിരി നല്ല സ്കോളേഴ്സിനെ ഞാൻ പരിചയപ്പെട്ടു. അതിൽ ഒരാളാണ് ഡോക്ടർ ഷാരിഖ് സാർ. ഹീസ് എ പി എച്ച് ഡി ഇൻ എക്കണോമിക്സ്. ഇപ്പോ അലിഗഡ് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിൽ നിന്നാണ് അദ്ദേഹം പി എച്ച് ഡി എടുത്തിട്ടുള്ളത്. അതിനു കൂടെ ഹാർവാർഡ് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിൽ അടക്കം ഇദ്ദേഹം ഈ ഇസ്ലാമിക് സബ്ജക്റ്റിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ട് ക്ലാസ് എടുക്കാനൊക്കെ പോയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ ഈ ഒരു കാറ്റഗറിയിൽ നമ്മളെ പോലത്തെ ഉള്ള മലയാളികൾക്ക് എക്സ്പോഷർ കിട്ടാവുന്നതിൽ ഇന്ത്യയിൽ അവൈലബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ബെസ്റ്റ് റിസോഴ്സ് ആണ് നമുക്ക് ഇന്ന് വന്നേക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ ഇന്ന് ഞാൻ ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നത് വെച്ചാല് ഞാനൊരു സ്റ്റുഡന്റ് ആയിട്ട് നിന്നിട്ട് എനിക്ക് ഒത്തിരി ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് നിങ്ങളിൽ നിന്ന് കിട്ടിയതുണ്ട്. ഇത് സാറിനോട് ചോദിക്കാം, സാറിൻ്റെ ഒരു വ്യൂ നമുക്ക് കിട്ടാം. ഇത് വെച്ചിട്ട് ഇനി അതൊരു ഒരു 30-45 മിനിറ്റ്സ് അത് കണ്ടിന്യൂ ചെയ്യാം. അതിനിടയിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചാറ്റിൽ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ചോദിക്കാം, എന്നിട്ട് ഞാനത് ചാറ്റിൽ എടുത്തിട്ട് സാറിനോട് ചോദിക്കാം. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞ് ലാസ്റ്റ് 15 മിനിറ്റ്സ്, 11:45 to 12 o'clock, നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ചോദിക്കാം. ഇൻ കേസ് യു വാണ്ട് ആസ്ക് ഇൻ മലയാളം, യു ക്യാൻ ആസ്ക് മീ. ഐ വിൽ ഞാൻ ഇവർക്ക് സാറിന് ഞാൻ ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് കൊടുത്തോളാം. ഇൻ കേസ് സാറ് പറഞ്ഞത് എന്തെങ്കിലും മനസ്സിലായില്ലെങ്കിൽ ഞാൻ ട്രാൻസ്ലേറ്റ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് തരാം. ഇനി അതല്ല, ഈ വീഡിയോ കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് നമുക്ക് അടുത്ത സെഷനിൽ എന്തെങ്കിലും ക്രിട്ടിക്കലായിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഞാൻ അതിനെ കുറിച്ചിട്ടുള്ള വീഡിയോസ് ഞാൻ ഇറക്കിക്കൊള്ളാം. കാരണം ഞങ്ങൾ ഇതിനെ കുറിച്ച് സംസാരിക്കേണ്ടായില്ല, എന്റെ ബിലീഫിലും കുറെ കാര്യങ്ങൾ വ്യത്യാസങ്ങൾ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. സോ ഐ നീഡ് ടു യുനോ സ്റ്റഡി അഗെയിൻ ആൻഡ് അഗെയിൻ. ദിസ് ടോപ്പിക് ഇസ് എ വാസ്റ്റ് ടോപ്പിക്. വി നീഡ് ടു ലേൺ, വി നീഡ് ടു റീലേൺ and start making changes. But the important thing which we need to understand is that it's a peace of mind we need to have. We have a belief. According to this belief, we invest, and at the same time we have to protect our money. we have to create wealth, we have to ensure that all our responsibilities are met with our investment, in the same time our beliefs are protected. So our effort today is to learn this from a master who has been with so many things. He has helped National Stock Exchange and Bombay Stock Exchange to set up Sharia based indices. So the index which you see as a Sharia index, his hand is there when he's created. Not only for India, for Bangladesh Stock Exchange, he has done this work. And for NBFCs, in Kerala also, we have a NBFC Seraman, then we have a Highlight Builder. So for all those people, when they have set up a Sharia-based investment product, he was there to advise them. And in India, most of this Sharia-based business deal happened, his advice was taken. So if all this can be contributed, we can learn from sir and see that what we can take it, and when we invest, what are the things we can mindful about it. And it's an evolving thing. So whatever questions you can ask. So today, I'm so pleased and humbled to welcome a person who has real knowledge about Islamic way of investing. And we can learn from him. And when we next time invest, we have any doubt, all this doubt can be removed from today. And in future also we will have doubt, then we can bother him, probably we can bring him again and talk, or you know, we can mail and get this clarification. With that, I would like to open this conversation. So first of all, my sincere thank you and to Sharik sir. The moment I asked him, he said ever ready in WhatsApp. Then we had a conversation and checked that how we can do it. Today he had a business meeting in some other place, because he didn't go for that, because he need to make sure that the internet capacity should be good. Then he has to stay in Mumbai. So he has canceled some important meeting for all of us. Thank you, sir, on my behalf, and all my audience behalf. And let's start the conversation. So first of all, welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Nikhil. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to me. Good morning, Assalamu Alaikum, and welcome everyone right from India and Middle East. I know a lot of people have sent me messages from Middle East as well. So thank you, Nikhil, for organizing this, and I look forward to having a very exciting discussion.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. So we have people from US and people from Middle East and people from across Kerala. It's part of it. Majority are Malayalis, I think a few people also joined non-Malayalis also. But so anyway, we don't have an option to talk in Malayalam. So let us continue in English. To put everyone on the same page, could you explain in a shorter version that what is a Sharia way of investing for all of our understanding? If you can start with that, we could take forward on this discussion, sir.
Okay, thank you, Nikhil. And this is a good question to begin with. First of all, I'll spend a minute on explaining what Sharia itself is, and that will give background of what Sharia investing is. So Sharia basically means, in literal sense, it is a path to take to the source, a path that takes everyone to the original source. And from Islamic point of view, Sharia means understanding of the wisdom or the intent of the creator, how a believer should live a life. So Sharia basically means understanding of Islamic law in a simpler way, but its real meaning is trying an attempt to understand the will of creator, to be able to understand the wisdom behind the law. Coming to the affairs of the believers, relationship between God and relationship between people are identified very clearly from Sharia point of view. And in all the matters which are related to the worldly affairs, which is not related to people and the God, is known as worldly affair. And in this case, Sharia rule is very clear that whatever is prohibited, you avoid that, and everything else is allowed. So in all the worldly affair, whether it is financial, political, social, etc., all these matters, the only requirement from a believer is to look at if he is or she is indulging into any prohibited or not. If not, then everything else is allowed. So and coming back to very quickly on financial sector, this translates into it is not the financial sector which is prohibited. It is not this market or that market which is prohibited. Everything has to be seen from the angle that if Sharia has prohibited certain activities, certain participation, certain businesses, certain transactions, then we have to find that. And once we able to find that, we will have to avoid it. So that is related to the financial sector. Coming back to very quickly in capital market, if you translate the same understanding of Sharia, then we have to see that once you buy a share, once you buy an equity, you become actually owner, part owner to that extent of your investment into the activities of the company. Now, if you are part owner of the company and company is doing something which is prohibited in Sharia, then the onus comes on you as well. And therefore, Sharia screening has been evolved, has been created to make sure that a believer who might not have in-depth understanding of the business's activities and ability to find those things, whether it is prohibited or not. So Sharia screening is actually a process to help investors in capital market to choose investment which falls within the permissible limit of Sharia. And coming to the process, now there are two processes for those people like you who have been in working as a fund manager and guiding people. There are two very important requirements from Sharia point of view. Number one, we have to look at company's business. What do they produce? What the company produces? What activity it does? That is known as business screening. So if the company is into any kind of socially harmful sector, and also sectors which are prohibited. I am saying socially harmful sector in the sense that as far as socially harmful sectors are concerned, there is no difference between Sharia and non-Sharia. Everybody wants to participate in activities which is known as responsible investment in today's time, in those activities which are not causing harm to the society. For example, pollution, for example, tobacco, for example, child labor, etc. But in addition, Sharia also has its own morality, and which means that if you are lending money and earning interest out of it, that is not allowed. Because money is not a factor of production. Money itself is not a factor of production. So clubbing altogether, Sharia investment means that following law or following investment where Sharia doesn't prohibit becoming part of those activities and earning profit out of it.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So I think, you know, we have very clear that there are certain things are prohibited as per the law. And could you just quickly mention that what is that prohibited thing? What is that allowed activities in terms of business?
So it is difficult to give the whole list. But I'll give indication, because whatever is prohibited in Sharia, the principle is you cannot earn at the cost of others.
Okay.
So I cannot earn at the cost of others, and I cannot earn at the cost of society. That is the fundamental principle. I am allowed to earn, but I cannot earn at the cost of you in the sense of making harm and causing harm to you. Now, if you look at this principle, how it is applied, and in addition to this, for example, there could be subjective elements involved. For example, financial sector, which is dealing in only riba or interest-based activities, that is considered to be disallowed from Sharia point of view. In fact, interest or biaj, what we call, is not only prohibited in Muslim religion. I know that in Hindu religion, there is a cap on rate of interest charged. And there are certain segments of society which are not allowed to deal in interest. So in all religion, if you look at, there has been attempt to control interest and riba. There has been attempt. And right from the oldest religion, which is Hinduism, to Judaism, it has been controlled, and then Christianity, and then Islam. how it has come to be a modern day practice is another subject matter for discussion. But bottom line is that all major religions, global religions, have had an attempt to control charging and paying of interest, because renting out money is abhorred activity, is disliked activity. Money is not a wealth in itself. It represents wealth. When a representative is charging, it comes at the cost of other factors of production. So because of this, financial sector, which deals primarily on interest-based activities, is completely prohibited from Sharia. So that whatever is the Islamic version of it, there you can participate. So that is one. And other than that, alcohol, gambling, tobacco, vulgar entertainments, armaments also, some Sharia scholars. In India, we do not believe that armament is disallowed, because India per se has not been an aggressor country. So there are certain areas where you may have subjectivity involved, looking at the real local situation. But in certain areas, scholars are very, very clear that these are no-go areas, like I mentioned. And in addition, of course, in today's business, you know that companies are into various kinds of activities. They are into mixed activities. So that is where it becomes very difficult. For example, hotel is very important Sharia need, but then hotel earns money out of non-halal food, out of alcohol, etc., and vulgar entertainment. So there are some technicalities involved, but we have experts, and India has been center of research on Sharia screening for across the globe. Okay. Across the globe. So SNP Research Center, which manages Sharia indices across 70 plus countries, their research team is based out of Bangalore. So India is lucky to have some of the best and finest researchers as far as Sharia screening and Sharia investment is concerned.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so I think, you know, what I can understand from your talk is that from AMNC like us is that bank clear no, NBFC is clear no, all this gold loan is clear no, anything to do with the word interest is clear no, then alcohol it's clear no, gambling is it's clear no. Gambling, I think you
clear no, yes. Whatever then, you earn at the cost of other. You see, gambling and trade is a very, very interesting example. If you see trading, both the parties win at the conclusion of their transaction. Otherwise, trade will not happen. In gambling, two parties transact, but only one will win and other will go with hard bun.
Okay.
So that is the difference between gambling and trade. Gambling often ends up negative return, or even zero-sum game, or even negative return. At trade, both parties are happy. Gambling, again, if you look at the principle, that you cannot earn at the cost of others, is has to be applied, actually. No, there could be examples where you end up earning. Sorry?
No, one question I have is that gambling, I know it's a clear no, but just for the other's sake, okay? Gambling means I'm taking risk. I'm not. I'm taking enough risk. Then, actually, what is the harm in taking gambling? I'm not talking about what you call the going to casino. I'm talking about instrument.
Okay.
There is no gambling. See, it is gambling. I don't know, but I'm taking my own risk. My money. I'm taking the risk. And what is the problem?
Okay. That brings me to another interesting aspect. Many a times we tend to claim from Islamic point of view, and those who are in Islamic field, that no gain without risk. Mm. So that tend to give us an impression that Sharia means that without taking risk, you cannot earn.
Mm.
Right. Now, we have to understand things in perspective. There are many segments where there is no risk, but the gains are allowed. Literally, there is no risk. And there are many areas which are risky, but not allowed. So gambling, in one of that sense, is no doubt risky, but actually too risky, number one. Number two, if you look at the technical point, how gambling is not allowed. So coming to prohibition, as I said, that Sharia in worldly affair allows us to look at only prohibited segment. So riba or interest is one. Gharar is another one, and gharar in Arabic can be translated as G-H-A-R-A-R, which means that extreme ambiguity, or in economics language or economics parlance, we can understand that where rights and obligations of the parties are unclear. When two people are gambling with each other, who will get at what, it all depends on chance, right? So even parties are paying, but what and who is going to get return of that is actually unclear at the time of entering into a contract or at the time of transaction. That makes gambling fall in the category of gharar, and gharar also is prohibited, number one. Number two, if you look at the social point of view, gambling is a kind of activity for more for mental satisfaction of the people who like to keep idle or who like to stay idle, and they have money. So yes, somebody can argue counter against this, that a rich person is wanting to play his money, and a lot of people are employed in that. So at least some kind of economic activities are happening. But again, if something is socially harmful for the society at large, then obviously, if you allow that at a bigger level, then it will only multiply the harm. For example, riba also. There is no doubt that some people benefit out of it. Riba, when I'm lending money and you are willing to pay, it doesn't mean that our willingness makes riba allowed. Although, if you are willing and I have not forced you, then you know your capacity to repay, and accordingly, you are borrowing from me. So what is harm in allowing me a benefit which is coming at your willingness? But it is, riba is not only a matter of transaction between two individuals. If this kind of activities are allowed, then obviously productive capital, no capital owner would want to take risk tomorrow if this is allowed. So who will take risk? Entrepreneur is the only factor of production. Who is taking risk from economic activity? Now, if the entrepreneur is forced to take capital risk also, then it will come at the cost of society, because all other factors of production will get less as much as it is paid to the capital owner. So capital, which is a servant of people, should not be allowed to become master of people. Just because a person is having money, it doesn't mean that he is really contributing to the society. Real contribution to the society comes from entrepreneur who assembles all the factors of production, create wealth, takes risk, and shares returns with everyone. I hope it's clear now.
Sir, I think, you know, it's clear. So there are a lot of questions about there are a lot of things about intraday trading. There are things about swing trading, because people are learning about trading, and they are, especially after March, the situation has in market, it has really shown some good movement, and a lot of people entered into market and seeing that every day they are making money, and they are doing. I know that once you take the delivery and then you are become an owner, then it's possible. But intraday, what is your take on participating in intraday? With the leverage, not, I don't have money, but my broker is giving leverage. Can I enter into this intraday trading?
Okay, that's an interesting technical question, Nikhil, and I hope I'm able to convey the message that I wish to on this question. Number one, we have to differentiate between short selling and intraday.
Okay.
Because what happens in the capital market mostly, the moment we say intraday, it also refers to something which is short selling. And short selling from Sharia point of view and short selling from the normal practice point of view might not be the same. So let me tell you, first of all, that what is short selling from Sharia point of view? From Sharia point of view, short selling means you are selling something that you do not own. Mm-hmm. You do not own. At the time of sale, whatever you are selling, at the time of sale, that item was not in your possession. Now, taking this capital market, when you think, or when you imagine, or when you believe that certain stock prices are going to go down, and therefore you sell prior to buying it, and you have set plan, and you are right also, let's say. So you thought that X share will go down by the evening, then you sold it first, and by the evening you have squared it out. So if you sold at high price and you bought at lower price, and bought and sold transaction will completed on T+1 basis. So on T+1, when you will be required to deliver, you will also be eligible to get a share that you sold in the evening day before. Therefore, that can be squared off. Now, if this squaring off is from Sharia point of view, if you look at, if you sold it before owning it, then it is not allowed. Because anything that you sell without being owner, then you are jeopardizing the interest of the real owner. Can I sell your house? Can I sell your vehicle? How can I be allowed to sell your Reliance shareholding?
Yeah, okay.
Right? So that means the moment I do something which is not in my own position, ownership, I am jeopardizing the interest of the real owner. And that cannot be, again, same Sharia principle. You cannot earn at the cost of others. I cannot be allowed to take the risk of your ownership. But if I'm having X shares in my control, let's say, and I feel that by the evening it is going to go down, so why should I ride during the whole, why should I own the share the whole day? I sell in the morning, I buy in the evening, my ownership remains same, my ownership doesn't change, but I did not sell someone else's stock. I sold my own stock. So here, two perspectives, both can be day trading, but one is permitted and another is not, for the fact that in one case I was owner and in another case I was not. So that is the major difference. And as far as timing is concerned, because many a time people think that you have to take ownership, like what you said, but ownership means what? Ownership means delivery. Delivery might take time also. The moment you buy a share, you have become owner. It is only a technical matter that it will come after clearance a day later than tomorrow. It is going to be T+2 transaction. But everything associated with that stock is now in your possession. So even if we have bought now, and after a minute, you feel that, you know, I might have taken a wrong decision. Nothing stops from Sharia point of view to sell it. I cannot force you to buy and hold it for X amount of period time. And in that, if some prices crash, then who is suffering? I have made you suffer despite you were owner. So if you are an owner and you want to get rid of ownership, nothing in Sharia stops you, even if you have been owner for a minute.
Okay.
So there is no time limit from Sharia point of view as far as ownership is concerned. I hope I'm clear.
Yeah, it's very clear, sir. So I think, you know, this is something we need to really be understanding the law and see that what is my real need? Am I really protecting my risk or am I really taking advantage of the people around? I think that more of an ethicality comes here. I think this is something that before taking an investment decision, we need to be understanding this entire logic behind why I'm doing it. I think, you know, now I'll just move on to other topic because, you know, this is so many things to discuss. In terms of investing, we have this question that, you know, I have many industries because we talk about a prohibited business lot, but there are companies like pharma companies, there are companies like IT companies. If you look at Infosys as a company, we always call that as a company which is Sharia because IT is a allowed type of a business. But if you look at Infosys as a company, their major customers are banks. Their money earning from banks. If you look at what you say that even pharma also, there are even pharma and IT also, even though they have money, there are chances that they take a lot of loans to do an infrastructure company. The companies like L&D, they may have reserves, crores of rupees reserve, but when they enter into some of the contract, they take loan to fulfill that particular project. So this is the question that financial, how it play and from where that money is coming in. So in terms of me as an investor in India, this is a norm. This is not a place where everyone is following Sharia. But I am a person who believe in this. How I can participate and make sure that how I use my surplus money in terms of making sure that my future needs are met.
You are putting me in difficult situation, Nikhil. So let me start with IT companies. Many IT companies, you gave one name. Those who have clients whose income is not compliant. See, if you look at Infosys itself, that name you have taken. Is Infosys a bank? You will say no. Is Infosys earning, the main object of earning money is through interest? You will say no. The problem is Infosys is serving client whose income is not halal. That, let's say, banking sector. Now, this is a very interesting question. Let's say you have a hospital. Do you have means to know that all the people who you help have halal income and then only you will help them? That is a question, right? So Sharia puts a full stop somewhere. That you your client's income status, whether it is halal or haram, will not make your income status halal and haram as long as you yourself are not part of haram. That is one logic. Obviously, some Sharia scholars do not agree with this logic, but great majority of Sharia scholars are very clear about this. So those who do not agree, they say that most of the IT systems are actually helping interest-based system grow their businesses. So it is not only that they are earning income out of it, they're also strengthening the banking system, and which is a haram system. So some Sharia scholars do not agree with that. Now, this is a real life situation. In any rule, if you look at, you will have people having different opinion. And I think that is not a bad thing, because even different opinion brings some value addition to the debate on the table, the whatever we have discussion. So some believe in that. Now look at from Islamic point of view also. All major international banks have Islamic windows, Citi Islamic, HSBC, Grindlays, etc. Now, if this was the rule, then we would never allow most of the banks to start Islamic windows, because their whole money is interest-based money. Their shareholders are there. So that means we will never have, in real sense, we will never have Islamic banking if we are a true believer in this rule, right? So one option is, now when you discuss with Sharia scholars, they say that, do you want Citibank to keep using all its money for interest-based purposes? Or do you want Citibank to assign some money for non-interest-based businesses also? So we are helping them move towards non-Islamic. If they are successful, we are adding value to them. We are convincing bankers to do banking without interest. So there is always a value judgment. Looking at ground level situation, you will have people who will be into this category, this school of thought, and who will be in that school of thought. And this I think is a strength of the society. I cannot take a position that no, this entire should be not allowed or should be allowed. I'm telling both the positions of the scholars. And I also personally believe that in real life also, we do not have a real control over the earnings of the client. Let's say somebody brings money to you for investment. You will do all technical diligence, AML and etc., KYC, etc. But in real sense, you do not know whether the person has earned money through right means or wrongful means. And even if the person is not, then you are not responsible, because there are agencies that should be taking responsibility of making sure that people earn in rightful manner. But that is beyond your capacity, and you cannot go and check everyone that prove that your money is rightfully earned or not. So there are limits to wealth managers. There are limits to Sharia scholars. There are limits to policymakers also. And the limits are that you cannot go beyond the point of obvious. If, let's say, Infosys, what about a furniture supplier to bank? Is it not allowing people to sit in the bank comfortably and do business? Is he also? What about people serving non-lending businesses in the bank, etc.? So a lot of areas, if you start with this, tomorrow you'll say that you cannot supply furniture. day after tomorrow you can say that you cannot do this, you cannot supply stationery, right? Then you have to count how many pens was bought by bank and how many pens was bought by, and then bank will come the other way around. Bank will send Nikhil as a fund manager, and bank will, Nikhil will buy because Nikhil is Sharia compliant. So obviously, you know, in the process, you do not want to create loopholes also. You want to be logically very straightforward that this is allowed and this is not allowed, and here is the boundary line. Now, if you extend the boundary line beyond the real people, then obviously it is not going to hold. So I think pragmatically and practically, this is a good judgment. This is a good decision that companies which are not directly earning haram should not be made responsible for the income of their client. That is about the Infosys and IT companies. Now, some companies might be fully dedicated to that, could be another issue. For example, some companies only for banking services. Again, you may take, you know, some banks have their IT companies, and those IT companies have branched out and they are serving only dedicatedly financial sector. Again, you may have, this is something which is a gray area. So you have white and black and gray area. You can take call based on what is where you are comfortable with. So I'm not trying to give judgment. I'm just trying to tell the situation that this is the real life situation, and people are most welcome to follow the call of their heart.
What we are trying to understand here is that this is a law we need to understand very clearly, and at the same time apply your common sense also. That way, it's not we can't really take the advantage of something, but instead trying to see that what is that understanding of your law, and it is within that. I think Infosys is a very good example which we can take.
Yes, Nikhil, I must tell you that Sharia is very logical. So if we cannot find logic, you know, I believe that Sharia is from God. If God cannot be logical, who else could be?
Sir, if Sharia is
God's message.
But my question is, it has created years back, and now here no one is here knowing that, you know, we all learning this from the books and from other pundits or scholars. But when it comes to financials, how do we kind of see? I can't go and ask a scholar who is teaching me in certain places about Islamism. They are not really expert in this rule. And I think, you know, I want to kind of, I think this is because we have a time limit, because I have other things also to cover other than a stock market, because you have sent that good screen, which I just wanted to showcase everyone that the opportunity available in India listed companies. This is, where is it? I think, could you just explain that, you know, what is in India? Because this talks about the opportunity in India for people who believe in Sharia, where you can go and invest. The number, I think, please correct me if I'm wrong. I think in India, in the entire world, the Sharia compliant opportunity available is much better in India other than other countries, I think.
That's absolutely correct, Nikhil. This is one slide. I can talk for 2 hours. Unfortunately, you are not going to give me that much time. To say this in a very short, in a nutshell, I would say that at any point in time, the last and the smallest bar shows number of Sharia compliant stocks in India on the most conservative screening norm. So right from 2012 to 2019, any period, except that 2015, you had 982 stocks. Otherwise, always you had more than, or we had more than 1,000 Sharia compliant stocks. This is maximum as far as any individual country is concerned. Yeah. Maximum. So if you look at the maximum number of Sharia compliant individually in any country, then it is, this India is the place to be. That is one. If you look at group of countries, then this number is more than entire GCC. All GCC countries put together will not have 1,000 stocks Sharia compliant as India alone has. This is second perspective. The third is, if you look at number of stocks in Middle East, you will see certain sectors only, right? You will have pharma, you have real estate, you have a banking sector, et cetera, some not pharma. In fact, real estate and some oil and gas. If you look at Indian economy, it is manufacturing, it is trading, it is services, all kinds of companies you will find. So it is steel, it is pharma, it is medicine, it is FMCG, it is real estate, it is IT sector. You name it, you have Sharia compliant companies in that sector. So from diversification point of view, from number of stocks point of view, from liquidity point of view, India provides one of the best opportunity for Sharia compliant investor. Unfortunately, we have not been able to market this the way we should have. And that is the reason that India continues to be the least developed country as far as Islamic finance is concerned. And that is where I think that NRIs have an important role to play. I wish that we are able to do something. Nikhil, I'll stop here because otherwise I can go.
So I think from here on, I think if you can answer, you know, much faster, because I think there are things like insurance. Is it allowed? One is that there are two insurance, okay, mainly from a personal finance point of view, health insurance and medical, our term insurance. What is your take on that? Because there is a belief that insurance is not Sharia.
You see, again, a very logical way to put it. Insurance is what? Insurance is basically distribution of risk. Right? 1,000 people facing same risk have contributed some money between in a pool, and anybody who suffers is paid out of that. Now, if this is the concept of insurance, now look at Prophet's life, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet Muhammad, when somebody injured someone, the cost of injury was spread on the entire tribe. That had two controls. One is somebody accidentally killed someone. Now the tribe whose person was killed will demand a ransom. And there was a tradition that family has to be supported of the person who was killed. And who will pay? The person who has killed has to pay. Now, if the demand for ransom or demand for money to protect the family of the killed is so much that this person who is alive can also not survive them, then his risk was distributed on his entire tribe. Now, this way, financial burden was distributed over the large number of people, which was actually on one person. Now, this is one example we get from Prophet's life. This had other social consequences, social positive results also, because people would control their bad people also, if the cost is on them. So all these were there. And insurance also, if you look at Arab traders used to come to India and especially Kerala, etc. They had a fund because they know that somebody might not return at all. So they had a fund to support their family. Now, anybody who doesn't return, anybody whose tradables were lost, they had contributed fund because they knew that today it is someone, tomorrow it could be they. So insurance concept is concerned, it is perfectly fine from Sharia point of view, because insurance is just making ex ante arrangement rather than ex post arrangement to mitigate the risk.
Okay.
Insurance is distribution of risk. Now, how it operates in modern day time is that is where Sharia issue comes in, because it again operates on the basis of gharar, it operates on the basis of riba, and it operates on the basis of non-compliant investment. If you resolve these challenges, right? Because if you look at today's insurance company's client, their interest and company's interest are always at loggerhead. Insurance company will deny and the policy holder will try to get more, because it is just like gambling. You know, my profit will come only at the cost of yours, and your profit will come only when you deny me the claim. So today's operational mechanism for insurance is concerned, that is where Sharia has issues. And then whatever the way we solve that these issues, once it is resolved, that is known as takaful. And takaful is basically Islamic insurance. So if the concept of insurance itself was not allowed, takaful would not be there. It is not that. Problem is with the operational mechanism, not with the concept of insurance.
I think just if you can, you know, just quickly just talk about this book is written by sir, and I think it mentioned so many things about it's available in Amazon. So I'll put that link for all of you in case if you want to look at it. This is a book. I think it's talking about takaful and how Islamic finance can be, you know, operated in a much better way.
Yes, Nikhil. So one of the chapter which is freely available, you don't have to spend money on that, is the takaful journey. How takaful started? What is the ideological basis of takaful? And what are the models that are currently in practice? as far as Takaful is concerned. So that chapter is available on Google, on Amazon. And in case Nikhil, somebody doesn't get that, so they can get in touch with you, and I will share with you that chapter. So that talks about the whole journey of Islamic insurance, how it has evolved till date.
I'll just share that. If you can, you know, send that when I put the recorded video, I will just mention that. So I think, you know, quickly I'm just getting into other topic, because there are so many things.
I know
our discussion, but you know, I think we haven't covered what we have discussed so far. Actually, I think, sir, credit card, I'm paying my credit card bill before my due date, and I'm not paying interest. Is it correct to hold credit card if I'm ensuring that my dues are paid within time?
Okay, that is another very difficult question, Nikhil. I hope some of the friends who hold different views than I might not be very happy. But let me tell you very frankly and honestly that credit card serves some very important purpose. Now, it is not just a lending instrument. So there are people who say that the moment you buy credit card, you have already entered into a contract which is interest bearing. That is correct. But that is correct for saving account also. That is correct for current account also. But people do have saving account, people do have current account, because their purpose is not to earn or pay interest, but their purpose is to facilitate their business transaction. Because otherwise, if you don't have bank account, how will you receive payment? How will you make payment? Similarly, credit card can also serve different purposes. Some people want to have it as a showpiece.
Okay.
That is obviously disallowed or not liked for different reasons. But there are business people. Now, business people make a small and big payment here and there. And at the end of month, they get the bill, consolidated bill. And that bill is attached with the voucher. And that becomes enough proof for making payment by the company executives. So credit card serves very important purpose. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult for an individual to make payment through debit card and collect all these things and go and make voucher and collect that money from company. That becomes very difficult. So it helps in accounting, it helps in consolidating expenses, etc., etc. So there are many friends who use credit card only for the company businesses or business expenses. Okay. There are people who just cannot manage their income, and they want to rely on credit card to facilitate their consumption. That I think is definitely not allowed. That obviously takes you into a indebtedness, and that is beyond the scope. So credit card is an instrument that helps you in different way, but it is a kind of two-edged sword. It can harm you also. So how you use that is most important. And from Sharia point of view, any wastage is disallowed. You cannot waste resources. Even water prophet has said that even if you are sitting, if you are nearby a river, you cannot waste water just because water is flowing. So it is a very responsible. Sharia expects people to be very responsible, irrespective of the fact that how much money they have, they are not allowed to waste it. How much resources they have, they are not allowed to waste it. And obviously, you cannot borrow when you don't have resources to pay for. So that is the point. And I'm cutting it short because I know you have many other questions to ask.
I think, you know, this is something, if you really look at it, the Sharia is pure personal finance. In personal finance, first thing is budgeting. And in budgeting, make sure that there is no wastage, unnecessary spending.
I think absolutely. Absolutely, Nikhil. Absolutely, you got the point.
Okay. Yes. So, and I think, sir, this is the one thing which is particularly for people from Kerala. We invest in business. We go and give money to jewelers. We go and give money to business people. And we collect a fixed return. And we say that I'm investing in business. And this is Sharia. What is your point? Because we think that putting money in bank is not allowed because I earn interest. But if I'm giving this money to a person who is running business, he will give me a fixed rate of return. It's like conveniently or unknowingly, we are ignoring the fact that this is a profit or interest. I don't want to know. I'm assuming that it's a profit. Which business, tell me, sir, getting fixed return on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis?
That's another very tricky question, Nikhil. I may not have a blanket yes and right wrong or yes and no kind of response on this. But yes, I am coming across so many instances here in Mumbai also, where people take money from their friends because they do not want to borrow from other people, friends and relatives, and they invest money in the businesses and pay a fixed return on that. And people are happy also because those people who have savings surplus, they instead of going to bank, they are giving money to a friend who is running a business and they are getting fixed income, and that income is even higher than the bank. So they are happy that return is higher and it is Sharia compliant. Unfortunately, in many cases, it is not Sharia compliant, because any return that is linked to the quantum of amount lent will make it Sharia risk, will bring Sharia risk, because the return should be linked to the quantum of profit earned, not quantum of money invested. That is very clear. That should be. So it is not that my return is based on the amount of money I have given you 100,000 and you are giving me 5% of that, right? You have earned 100,000 and you are giving me 5% of that is okay. I have given you 500,000 and you are giving me 5% of my investment. That is going to make. Now, how do you account this? So sometimes it is possible that you give a fixed return, which is known as on account distribution, which is adjustable to the profit and loss account once the profit and loss is known. So for example, you give me 5,000 rupees that I have drawn in month of April, but whole year you will calculate. And once you know that total amount of profit that was to come to my account was 70,000 of my share, and out of that you have paid me 35,000. So 35,000 is due. You have paid me 80,000 and the actual profit I should have got is 70,000. So 10,000 extra is actually the amount that I have overdrawn. Now that overdrawn amount is adjustable to future profit, or that overdrawn amount should reduce my capital investment in you. So that is the point I'm trying to make. Any return on the amount rate of investment is not correct. Any return on the profit made is correct way to calculate it. And in between, if you have done that for convenience purposes, that is fine. That is on account distribution, but that is not a real profit.
Okay, good. I think, you know, this is one, you know, we have our discussion we thought for till 11:45. We have a few questions come from people. I think we'll now dedicate. There are other one more question. Let me ask this. Home loan, is it because there are people, we know that it's a home. I know that home loan is not come under Sharia principle, but it's a practical thing that everyone may not have that lakhs of crores of rupees to buy land. If, for example, if a person is sitting in Bangalore or Mumbai, I want to buy my initial stage of my career, I need some kind of a leverage. What is your take on that, sir? Then we'll get into the calls.
That is another very difficult question, Nikhil. Unfortunately, I think I may not find a reason to allow. Sharia is not easy to live, right? It requires commitment also on the part of believers. And it is very clear that the moment you enter into a situation where you are paying interest for the sake of having house, then there is a trade-off. And this trade-off takes you in the domain of your relationship with your God. You're not causing harm to someone, but definitely you are crossing a boundary line to protect your future interest. For example, not having a house today is going to be more expensive tomorrow than today, right? So people do enter. But personally, I feel that it is the sacrifice. Unless you make sacrifices, solutions will also not come. If everybody was putting money in bank, there would not be Islamic banking today. If everybody is allowed to buy a house, there won't be Islamic home scheme tomorrow. So I think that is a sacrifice. And personally also, Nikhil, let me tell you that I don't have a house. And my rental would be perhaps lower than my monthly installment cost. And for 15, 20 years of my life, I would have had 3 or 4 houses, but I have none today. But that is the cost of my belief. I'm fine. God has given me enough money to buy house, use on rental basis than own house. it doesn't matter if I don't have a house, if I die without having a house, it doesn't matter to me. But as long as I feel that I have been truthful, I have been faithful to my belief, I think that is also a very important point for us.
Thank you, sir. I think that's a very valid question. I think this is something which a lot of people, because I know there are people who have a true belief and they have dedicated their life for this, the belief. And but when it comes to buying a house, they don't have that corpus money and they have done this. So then I always tell that if you are doing that, then what you are talking about FD. Okay, let's move on to. I think there are I had this question, but this question is that what mode of investing in gold is permissible? Because we have a fund, we have a because in mutual fund, the 10% is debt component will be there. So I think that is a question. So what mode of investing in gold is permissible in our belief?
See, gold has also been a currency for a very long period of time in human history. And in fact, it has been one of the most stable currency. And after gold, paper became currency. And after that, we know that inflation problem is only because of the paper-based currency. So when you talk about gold, there's a lot of restrictions from Sharia point of view, because gold has also been used as a currency. But when you use gold as a commodity, you buy a commodity, hold it as long as you want, and then you sell it, because inflation adjusted, this gives you better return than keeping money in bank and not taking interest. So I think Kerala people are very smart in that sense, that whenever they have extra money, they rely on gold rather than rely on savings. And this is where I think demand for Sharia compliant financial paper becomes very important, because it is responsibility of the society to provide solution to people. If people are not provided solution, they will do whatever is the best or nearest possible solution to them. So Kerala people have been using this solution as a solution, because at least you are protecting yourself from inflation, number two, you are also making some saving. If you don't buy gold, then that money is likely to be spent. So immediately you have, the moment you have some saving, you buy gold. That helps family in the rainy days. And I think that has been a good strategy. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it is when you are buying gold, it has to be on the spot. And most of the people do it. They don't borrow gold.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. What's your view on cryptocurrency?
I'm not a great enthusiast of cryptocurrency, because cryptocurrency has all the risk that of a rupee minus the backing of the sovereign. So cryptocurrency is a currency, kind of currency issued by a group of technocrats, miners, owned by miners and people who have invested in that. So it is a long way before we start taking cryptocurrency as a serious alternative to real currency. As an investment tool, if people think that this is a good investment tool, again, Sharia rules apply, and they can take call according to their choices.
Are the sukuks with the fixed coupon rates are halal?
That's a very very good question. You remember my response when I said that taking risk is not compulsory in Islam. So many a times we think that unless you take risk, your return is not halal. That also is a wrong perception. Just like the perception that you must take risk, you must not take risk. Both are actually wrong views. So sukuk is what? Sukuk is comprising, sukuk is a kind of asset where the underlying assets are rental generating income. For example, you have got 10 houses. You are getting fixed rental. Just because rentals are fixed, it doesn't mean that it is interest. So fixation doesn't make a halal return compared same as interest rate. Interest underlying asset is the amount lent. And in sukuk, underlying asset is a income generating, utility generating asset. So if you have a house, you have given it on rent, and you are earning as same amount of rent as your friend who is earning same amount of interest, both cannot be equated, because if something happens to house, you have the risk. and nothing is going to happen to the capital that you have lent, and that is not in your hand. The capital risk is borne by your borrower, and still you are getting the return. Here, the house risk is owned by you, and therefore return is justified. So, same amount cannot make it right and wrong unless we go to the underlying transaction.
Yeah. So that is. So I think there are a lot of questions, and I think when it comes to investing as per Sharia belief, right? It's you should know that what you have to do. It's lot of things. It's written. The interpretation is different. But I won't recommend that in India that a pure Sharia you will get it. But you need to understand which asset you are getting it. That's what I not only in this talk, but the talk which I had always with Shariq sir has given me the point that you are a person, you should understand this the scenario, and you should use common sense. More than that, you should be very ethical. And don't think about your personal interest, but you think about what is the actual belief you want to, then take the decision. It is courageous decision. What I think Shariq sir is telling one thing very clearly, that I know the fact that he is a person who can definitely afford to buy a house in Mumbai, and he has followed that principle for making sure that his belief is intact. I think it's about your personal choice. Shariq sir is not just a person who talking about this, he's following this principle, and I have seen that what passion he has, and I think my knowledge, I can probably say that Kerala is the place where Islam started in India, and especially from my place called Kudungallur, and next to my house this is a mosque, it is there, and I enter that place also. And I proudly say that I'm from my place, and this is a place where Islamic and Christianity started in India. And so not only that, this interaction with people like Shariq sir and there are other people has evolved me my belief also. I can proudly talk that whatever my little knowledge I have, I can tell. And I can tell that this is what I can offer. If you as a person believing that this is happy and okay for you, then follow this way of investing. So with that, I just want to thank you to Shariq sir for spending this time for all the community. And I'm sure that this has benefited a lot to the people who have attended. We had about 80 plus audience who has come. And this shows that, sir, that in Kerala, people are really want to know this. And I always tell that Tata Ethical Fund has only 750 crore rupees, and Taurus has only 60 crore rupees, and I think another 3 crore for Sharia ETF. I think all put together we have only about 800 crores, and I think India's population is about 18% is Islam, Muslims, and out of that half percentage, that means 9% of Indian population is believing in this principle. And I don't know whether they know about these investment options available, and it's our responsibility that these are options are available, and don't get into any other fraud or anything, and make use of your belief, and make sure that along with your belief create your wealth also. I want to invite Shariq sir for giving the closing remarks for this session.
Nikhil, I don't think I'm left with enough energy to give my closing remarks. It has been a wonderful session, Nikhil, and I always enjoy a lot when I interact with you anytime, and the passion that you have shown, the depth of knowledge that you have shown, the sincerity that you have shown in making observations, making comments, and also making people financially included. That is commendable, Nikhil, and I wish you all the good luck in your ventures that you do, in the social work that you do. And I pray for you and your family and everyone who has attended the program today. And may God bless all of us. May God give us enough opportunities and peace and prosperity to everyone and our family member. And may we live in a peaceful manner with different communities, as has been the tradition of India. That with all our belief, we have our own traditions, our own religion, but nothing stops us interacting, collaborating with each other, supporting each other when it matters. And I hope that this is the future of India, when we can live peacefully with love and affection to everyone. This is my prayer, this is my belief, and I thank you very much, Nikhil, for the opportunity that you provided me today. May God bless everyone who has been part of the program today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you all for participating, because the satisfaction which we get is because you all came together and learned out of it, and the question asked. And I know that I have taken extra 30 minutes from the sir and from each of you on this topic. We will put this recording in YouTube channel, and those who are registered for the session, we will send you email also. So thank you, and happy investing and happy learning on this particular topic. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Nikhil. Bye.